Yeah, I think basically both for safety and environmental challenges, you know, these have been there for a number of years, and as you go into time, I think they're getting more and more difficult. Now, especially with these regulations, and rightly so, to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions, I think that is probably becoming the most difficult challenge which is being faced both by the regulators and the governments. The targets also set are pretty steep, you know, something like a huge reduction by 2050. What really I think people need to be working towards, I think it is to get to a target which is as stiff as being set for 2030 and 2050. The most important thing is to break them down into what can be done in the near term, what can be done in the mid-term, and what can be done in the long term. In the near term, I think the focus is going to be on what could be the steps required to bring about the operating parameters improvement. And I think that is being, as I see, the owners are focusing quite a bit on that, and you can see people talking about speed optimization, you can see people talking about trim optimization, you can see people getting into some kind of speed reductions as required, especially when the market does not really need the voice to be prosecuted at higher speeds. I think with these operating improvements, one should be able to then monitor as to what is the reduction in emissions, and some improvement I think would be, I would say, fairly sizable improvement should come through improving the operating parameters of ships, and that is the near term. As we go into time, and actually the work has already started there, the next step, or at the same time the steps will need to be taken to improve your efficiencies with respect to hull, with respect to machinery, with respect to engines, and maybe with respect to improving the fuel consumption on ships. And I think that has already, the people are working on it. Shipyards need to focus on improving hull profiles, getting to better propeller designs, so you can get some better efficiency. Maybe the paint makers will need to get on to a lot more on the, you know, smoother hulls, you know, and maybe longer lasting paints, which can give you a very low surface roughness on ships. And of course the engine makers probably would really need to get into more of design improvements, because the fuel efficiency has stayed pretty much, it has plateaued out the last about 15-20 years, which would need to be really improved. You know? And I can see the engine makers are not trying to also look at you know, more look at fuels which are going to be having lower sulfur emissions and carbon emissions. So I think as you can see, the fuel efficiency improvement is going to be the next thing, and what is really more important is people would now start to innovate things, you know, because once you already have had huge improvements in fuel efficiency, hull efficiency, propeller efficiency, I think what we need to really now start improving, or rather innovating, to see that where you can get that extra mile which is required to get the emissions lower. You know? So far what we are seeing is that the most of it what is going on is to desulfurize, you know, things like changing to LNG, changing to methanol. Actually, both for methanol and LNG, Indian Register already made the new rules for compliance with these methanol fuel ships and the LNG fuel ships. But again, these are again basically going to be desulfurizing the environment, you know. Decarbonizing, I think, to me, that appears to be the more difficult challenge, you know. As you go down the line, the finding the right fuel which will give you the lowest carbon emission. I think so far the only one which is seen at the horizon is the hydrogen, you know, which has its own problem because of a very low specific gravity and hence, you know, large volume required for the storage of hydrogen. I think that is going to be an area of some concern. But I think as we see that owners are already working on better operating efficiencies, people are taking assistance even from us toward better trim optimization. I personally believe that ultimately, till you really find the right fuel for the low carbon emissions, I think the what already seems to be in getting into place are the low sulfur fuels, starting with the 0.5% 2020. So I think that will come first, you know. And to get the carbons down, I think you will have to really make a mix and match between the lower carbon fuels and optimizing your speeds, maybe lowering the speeds to get lower emissions. And also at the same time, supplementing your energy through alternate fuels like your wind, solar. I think those combinations will need to be worked upon. And I think what is more important is the cooperation between different stakeholders, be it the fuel makers, the engine makers, the ship owners, the classification societies. I think that is where the effort will need to be all put together so people are able to collaborate, synergize, and get to the goal faster. Having said all this, I think the most important thing is that you would have seen that in the last few years, the safety part, we have talked about environment, you know, the short term, the medium term, and the long term. And when you talk about the overall safety, you will find that even since times immemorial, the safety was a concern, and most of the accidents occurred because of what we call the human error, you know. What is now happening is that so far the human error was more because of negligence, people not being attentive enough, you know, somebody misses a bearing and gets into a collision, somebody doesn't take proper soundings or looks at the sounding of the waters and runs aground. But I think today the more accidents are caused because of the lag between the advancement in technology and the human element's ability to keep up with the technology, you know. I think that would need to be addressed through better training, better recruitments, and unless the operator understands the technology 100%, I think you will have accidents not because of human error, not sort of really understanding, or you know, because of the lack of attention, but more because of the gap between the way the technology has moved and the inability of the human element to keep up with the technology. I think that is something which everybody, the regulators, the governments, the your people, the ship owners, they would need to address in training. And training means proactive training, you know. And people would need to really be extremely familiar with the technology before they really go on board to use it. I think these are the views on both the safety and the environment in the next few years. As I said, that this question I probably have partly answered in my first question, that what are the key barriers? And I think the key barriers as far as the environment is concerned, as I said, that so far if you improve your operational efficiency, designs, The main barrier seems to be the low carbon fuel, which probably so far only the hydrogen is being seen as the new fuel. So I think the key barrier is finding the right low carbon fuel. Obviously, I think what is more important is how well and how quickly innovation will take place to find better designs which actually contribute to lower carbon emissions and sulfur emissions. The other barrier, as I said, is I think the training the human element, to me, I mean, I really come from a operating background in shipping, which I was actually in the operation for last number of years, and few years I've been in the class area. I found that getting the right people to man your assets, I think that is the most difficult thing. We have had over a number of years, somehow shipping has not been able to attract the right talent to run your assets. You know, I feel maybe a better talent goes to the aviation industry. You know, maybe the life is a lot more attractive, you know, to be there as compared to sea. So I think finding the right people at the entry level, grooming them, training them, I think unless you are able to show the right people, that to me appears to be a barrier as far as running your assets at the optimum safety levels are concerned. So you got the search for the right fuel, the search for the right people, tie up with the right technology partners, and training your people to use that technology. I think these are going to be the key barriers. And as far as the opportunity is concerned, you see, in every threat, I mean, we all who are in shipping, all these, greener shipping, the low emissions requirement in the next few years, emissions, whether it is through the exhaust or it is through your ballast water or whatever it is, I look at it this way, the opportunities, you know, we talked about the threats and the challenges. The opportunities what I see are going to be in the form of that today you see, I mean, for the last about 10 years, we have been complaining about, the market being bad. The trade has slowed down, the growth. Ships relatively are in oversupply. And you have a fairly there is a huge imbalance between the supply and demand, you know. But as we see greener shipping, more efficient shipping, better people running ships, I think there is an opportunity. If the stakeholders, the owners, the designers, the financiers, if they can now pitch in and start investing in the right kind of ships, which will give you a greener world tomorrow and better technology, I see that the demand for such ships as and when they come in will be far more than the so-called outdated ships which emit more, which are run on a lower technology base, which are run by people who are probably not able to make it to the high entry barrier shipping. I think that fleet will command a premium, you know. And that is where I think investment today by owners who can invest in that or who really see a future in better shipping and more efficient shipping, I think they are going to be the beneficiaries maybe 5 to 10 years down the line. And I think that is something which I see is an opportunity for somebody. I mean, if I had the money to invest today in ships, I would not invest in run-of-the-mill ships. I would look at technology people who can give me better technology, who can give me better ships, who can give me a greener world tomorrow, which ensures both the quality of life on the planet, and the ship needs to make a huge contribution in that area. so that you know it can be a major partner in a lower emitting world. You know? You know, that probably is one of the more difficult questions, you know. See, we all have been supporters of improving the gender balance, you know. I'm sure other industries and plus in shipping. What I see that when I take a stock of the data, in shipping the ratio of women who are in shipping worldwide, that means both at sea and in the industry, is probably just about 2 to 3%, you know, which is hugely low. When I go back in time, almost about say 10 to 15 years, I mean, look at the aviation industry. And when I talk about the aviation industry, I talk more about the Indian aviation industry, you know. The cabin crew, you are aware, was generally well represented by girls, right? But in the last 10 years, you would know it, that the number of women pilots in the Indian aviation industry has moved from about 1% to about 19%. And they are doing a good job, you know. I mean, they are like anybody else. I mean, so I think that's one area where I found people coming in a large way. Looking at shipping, I think there are areas which already women should be there, but are still not there. And I think that is where policies need to be made by the government, where people are encouraged to you know, sort of bridge this gap and bring in a more gender balance in shipping, you know. There are difficulties, like almost about 5-6 years ago, whenever we did these campus recruitments, you know, for the, especially naval architects, you see seafaring girls or women getting into seafaring, going out to sea, I'm not too sure, I mean, whether on the navigation side, yes, but on the engineering side, I'm not very sure whether they would really like to be there. Because I think one of the biggest problems I've seen is that seafaring as a profession requires a lot of time away from families, you know, a couple of months away at a time. I'm not too sure, but I will not comment one way or the other. But like I tried telling my people that we recruit almost 10 naval architects from colleges every year, you know, so that they can be groomed to for plan approvals, for surveys, for everything. And in the first year, I got out of 10, I got almost 3 girls, you know. And then I thought that would probably get better. But in the last about 3 years, I have hardly had any girl applying for the naval architect, because they say even in engineering colleges, there are not too many girls applying for these subjects, you know. Probably they would go for something different, maybe medicine, maybe other. So I think one is policies, that where the stakeholders or the owners don't shy away from bringing women into shipping as a profession. And two, which I have no answer, how do you change the mindset of the girls to really look at shipping as an attractive career, you know? I think these two things would need to be really balanced out to attract more women professionals into the arena of shipping. But I think that probably time would come when if the policies are in place, this should start happening.